Hi, everybody. My name is Jonathan Levi. I don't know how many people here know me or don't know me. I know a few people in the audience. I'm going to talk about zero knowledge in kind of two different settings. One of them is going to be the permissioned kind of space that some of you guys, at least the rebellious guys, don't like, which is kind of all this stuff about, like, why do we need permission chains and why do we need zero knowledge in permission chains or why did we create permission chains? And I'm also going to talk about, like, public token world or public chains or open chains. And we look at what we can do with zero knowledge and what we shouldn't do with zero knowledge. And I'll try to be kind of, I'll try to adapt to kind of questions. So let's start with how many people here didn't hear about any example of what zero knowledge? Like a very intuitive example of, I have like two balls, I'm colorblind. I don't know, what's that? Did you hear anything today? Can somebody give me an example of a zero knowledge system? Yeah, Tim?
If you go shopping for alcohol and you don't want to show your ID with your birthday, but you want to prove that you're over 18.
Okay. So a good example is I'm going to go and shop for alcohol, and let's say in Germany, I need to, by the way, I got a nice Berlin shirt. I have to like just tell you, everybody, that I'm so happy to be here. So. Yeah, in the US, I have to show that I'm over 21. In Germany, I need to show that I'm over 18. But I'm revealing too much information by giving you my ID, right? So you see my home address, the color of my eyes, or other things like my like personal identifier, which I don't really need to necessarily in order to buy some alcohol. We'll talk about that system. There's a nice system called Identity Mixer. That is working in permission chains, but let me just give you a quick kind of, I don't know, let's say overview of what's going on in permission chain walls. Because I know most people here are looking at Zcash and Bitcoin and Monero and like looking at kind of public chains, and I'm just going to talk about that a little bit. How many people here work with enterprise settings? One, two, three, four. Okay, and the rest, open chains. Okay, rebellious, we don't want any governance, we don't want police. I get it. Okay, so Enterprise Blockchain 101, right? So a few years ago, let's say two or three years ago, people started talking about using the technology that is behind Bitcoin, right? Like a blockchain settings or a DLT, a digital or a distributed ledger technology, to digitize assets and to try to kind of look into, the simplest way to look at it is like, I'm gonna have a single point of truth, right? There's a single source of what's really out there. So if you look at the UTXO model, it's basically like the main mistake that people have like in blockchains at the beginning, like they don't understand that I'm not using, if I want to use blockchain correctly, I'm not using blockchains or a blockchain technology in order to log what is actually happening. The important thing to understand is what is in the blockchain is what's happening, right? So if I'm trying to transfer money from A to B, only after validation, let's say even in Bitcoin, only after validation, once everybody approved and that transaction is written to the next block, that's actually my state transition, right? So only then, that's the truth, right? So the actual writing to the blockchain is the event. And most mistakes that I see in blockchain, enterprise or non-enterprise, is people thinking, oh, I'm just going to log it so everybody has like, you know, I'm going to broadcast a record to a log, but it's really not the case, right? So many vendors started looking into this, and they said, okay, we love blockchains, and we started like creating a few. I started working with Hyperledger 2015. I'm going to talk about like me a little bit later, but just to give you the background of what's going on here, many people started talking about, okay, it's really a foundational technology, we're going to disrupt, et cetera, et cetera. It's really going to help people synchronize, especially when you have a multi-party deployment. But in many cases, especially in enterprises, it became pretty clear, at least to them, or at least to us, or at least to like the deployers, that we're not going to end up with only one chain. So even though I really like Bitcoin, and I think it's kind of the one true kind of decentralized coin, as a coin, I don't think that it's going to be like the only blockchain technology out there, right? And many people agree. The problem that we see, though, is that they don't talk to each other, right? So people are deploying a lot of blockchains in private permissioned settings, and they actually, if you don't use it correctly, instead of having the blockchain as a technology that's supposed to bring people together and to basically prevent a lot of disputes, we're actually going to end up having more silos. Okay, so this is kind of the main problem that we see today. Everybody's investing, everybody's behind it. You see IBM, you see Intel is behind it. You see like R3. There are many people that are getting into the blockchain space, especially even in the enterprise space. But forget about like token prices. But even though they support and they adopt the technology, they don't talk to each other, right? Like there's a big issue now with trust in terms of like who owns the infrastructure, who runs what. And we do see it publicly, and we see it like in deals that we have, is that people are always fighting on the what's the best layer one solution, okay? So that's one issue. The thing that we see, in addition to kind of having like all these arguments about what's the best layer one solution, is actually when we start deploying stuff in a setting when we have no trust, people begin to worry about what they share. So we're looking like, I can tell you like a life cycle of a normal kind of blockchain for enterprise settings, trade, finance, supply chain, we do stuff in identity, healthcare. Usually it starts with, we have a consortium, and day one, everybody wants to have a seat around the table, right? So everybody wants to vote. Everybody wants to validate. Everybody wants to kind of look at any transaction and have a saying into what is written to the blockchain. As we kind of make some more progress, after a while, many organizations tell you that, look, I don't care anymore. Like, really, it's like so difficult because I don't want to be liable for signing a transaction. I don't want to be liable for endorsing something. So at the beginning, they want to have a lot of control. When we start playing with stuff, okay, what is a valid transaction? What does it mean that I approve the transaction? Actually, especially in banking and finance, people want less liability. So there is a big difference between verifying a signature just for somebody to say, hey, this is Jonathan signing with his signing key or his private key compared to my kind of public key. That's like just a signature verification. People, especially in enterprise settings when it's highly regulated, don't want to have the liability. So we very, very quickly get into this world of, I don't want to share information with my competitors. I don't want to allow other people to see it. I have a lot of regulations already. This, like when I have any sector-based blockchain, you know, say in healthcare, right? So we have a few hospitals trying to share trial data. The participants of that consortium are actually competitors, right? They're all hospitals. They look at the data or as kind of the patients are actually the clients, right? They're the customers. Why would they share this information? So you think, like, I also thought so, right? So look, let's play the kumbaya and we all hold hands and we just share information. It's really tricky and you need to build a lot of trust in order for people to actually collaborate and cooperate, okay? And this is where you have that kind of this competition, right, kind of model, right? So we basically come in and try to collaborate and work together, but effectively, you end up very quickly into this, like, who can access my blockchain? Who can see this data? It's really sensitive. Let's start with a smaller consortium. And it's actually helpful in terms of regulations. We still have to go through all of that, and sometimes you don't want people to even share data that you shared, okay? So if we look at, like, kind of what drives this kind of permissioning, right? It's usually regulations, right? So we came up with saying, we don't know what's gonna be like the best layer of our solution. We build a layer that sits on top, and we are not trying to displace your blockchain, right? If you kind of, if you started going out with Ethereum, we're not gonna break up this relationship. We're gonna build some stuff on top of Ethereum. Same thing on Bitcoin and the same thing on Fabric or the things. So that was kind of our mentality at the beginning. And it actually worked pretty well. I'll talk about it a little bit more. But if you look at my background, this is not like a pretty slide, but I actually started, so I used to be a banker for many years. I'm an applied cryptographer. And when I was 23, I sold some nice technology to a company called S&P, Standard & Poor's. So it was kind of in the middle of my PhD and I dropped out and I switched to banking as part of this kind of M&A deal. And I stayed in banking for almost 10 years. So I actually kind of joined the bad guys, right? Like being a banker. And 2012, I left Goldman Sachs to start working on Bitcoin and moved back to Stanford, wanted to finish my PhD. So I kind of been like, I've done a lot of crypto, I've done a lot of finance. Now I'm kind of doing crypto finance, but I'll tell you like something interesting about the first project that I worked on. It was a company called Miro, and in Miro we had something called Miro Assets. That's a startup 2014, 2015 that was trying to model what Nick Szabo back in the day believed, you know, the guy from the smart contract spec. Like, we were trying to say, let's go radical on financial inclusion. So I'm just gonna tell you a few kind of, like, just experience that I had with, like, trying to be too open, too closed, and how I move around kind of this whole spectrum. Back in the day, we spent more than a year and many, many million dollars to try to convince the SEC that if we have a mirror asset, so let's say somebody in China, it's not just the use case, but this is just an example. We felt that some people should be able, So some people should have access to financial instruments, such as being able to buy an Apple share. So you have like different trends in kind of decentralized and distributed systems of like, let's bank the unbanked. We were thinking, sometimes I would like to be able to have access or an exposure to the Apple share price going up, but I don't necessarily need to have the Apple share. So why don't you create a mirror asset that is traded on a decentralized system, such as Bitcoin? And maybe if I could buy this portfolio, if Apple price goes up, I don't have Apple price, but I'll be able to benefit from that. Right? So if we kind of go back to banking, it's like a synthetic financial asset that reflects or that mirrors what is the Apple share price doing. It's like a tracker. Okay? Nobody wanted to kind of allow that, right? So of course the Chinese government, if they have any restriction for Chinese nationals, they didn't want us to go and disrupt it, fair enough. And also in the US, we had a lot of issues around, can we get a no action letter? Basically, we didn't want to be an exchange. We wanted to be like, I don't know, like the eBay of financial instruments, basically supply meets demand, like to be like the Craigslist, right? I spent a lot of time, I was the chief product officer, trying to define that role. So we had some technology and nice ideas, but some technology. And I was trying to get banks to adopt it because I was like a banker and I could speak the language and I could define a product that I thought that financial kind of players would like. It was really difficult. It was, when I say difficult, it's an understatement. It was impossible. So just looking back into what we tried to do, how many Bitcoin ETFs you have today that are regulated? Zero. This is like 4 years later. So that caused me at some point to realize, okay, what am I trying to do? Why am I trying to disrupt a market that doesn't want to be disrupted? So I had a switch of like, if I was in Goldman Sachs again, I couldn't buy into this unregulated stuff. I couldn't. I needed KYC and I needed AML, and there are other regulations that I have to kind of abide by if I'm a regulated market working in a regulated space. So I kind of try to do the other thing. I try to kind of, let's use this technology and to actually address what the regulator wants. So let's try to build a permission chain so that we'll have a settings where people, like you have to go through the KYC, like the know your customer. We'll have to be able to, or we will be able to support the AML regulations, the anti-money laundering regulations. And that was the main idea, right? So we started with, so what I've done here, right? We started to do the Bitcoin exchange that didn't work well. Worked with Dan Bonet and Vitalik to create the first Ethereum class. That was like end of 2015, if some of you remember or were in that space. That's where Ethereum came up with Frontier. So we worked to create the first Ethereum class, and back then we had a solution that was based on hash commit reveal, which is like HCR, which is kind of where the Acera name came from. That was Vitalik's help. And I started working on Hyperledger Fabric with IBM and other members, and that wasn't easy either, I'll have to tell you. Like, I was kind of nominated and I led the entire kind of Hyperledger Fabric release, and I don't know if you saw today the news about Brexit. So you have like 27 European kind of the EU members trying to vote against like Brexit, etc. We released the first kind of open source kind of Hyperledger Fabric version with 27 other organizations, with egos, with IP, with a lot of stuff. So that was like a very big, actually difficult thing to kind of handle in terms of governance, but it went out. And the next thing that we've done a year later is actually created a network that connects all this stuff. But I'm not going to talk about that right now. I want to talk about zero-knowledge proofs and how we use them, okay? So a few things that we do with ZKPs, I'm not going to talk too much about that, but basically, we're looking at confidential transactions like everybody else is doing. We're looking at identity, and I'll get back to Tim's example in a second. That's less interesting for this talk. But where people are trying to use zero knowledge in permission space and in open blockchain space, right? So digital identity, we're trying to like tokenize stuff without like tokenizing the exact thing. We're looking at, I'm trying to use zero knowledge proofs in order to prove that something works the way it's supposed to be. And I'm going to talk about like the minute details about zero knowledge, because there are a few things I'm going to break here now. I'm trying to like look like a cowboy. It's going to start very soon. But there are many flaws in security designs of most of these systems. And now I'm going to talk about, I'm going to bash a lot of things soon in a diplomatic way, but I want to talk about like how many wrong assumptions we are making when we're trying to securely design distributed systems. Governance is a huge pain, even in permission, even when, actually, I don't know if it's more or less, but it's the same problem that we have today. Like you saw Mr. Song like saying that Vitalik is controlling Ethereum and that's why Ethereum is not decentralized. And I actually see Vitalik trying to do less and less and to decide less and less and to kind of give the keys to other people and to try to actually decentralize it. But there's another question, like, is the goal to be 100% decentralized, or is the goal to not allow other people to oppress other people? So that's the question, right? Like, do we want to have the benevolent dictator thing when we trust some people, or we just say, look, we have this technology, we'll put it out there, and nobody can block it? So I'm going to talk about like the philosophy behind these things and how zero knowledge proofs supposed to help, but it doesn't always, right? So let's talk about it. So we started talking about permission in a shared KYC model, right? So we said KYC is too centralized, and I was trying to put kind of my Bitcoin hat or the Ethereum hat. How do we do a shared KYC system where you don't have kind of some party controlling the whole thing? So if you think about it, know your customer by definition is not necessarily a good thing, right? Because you can go through a KYC, I can make you go through a KYC process and actually use it against you. So all this privacy is out of the window. Let's forget about that, right? I have to do KYC and look at my bank account and my social security number, et cetera, et cetera. So that's problem number one. Problem number two, who is that KYC provider? Like, if I want to go in this kind of, let's go and decentralize the world, and I don't want governance and I don't want anything else, then KYC is actually against you. But at the same time, let me tell you about, like, this is one of the big usages that we had when we started designing permission stuff in Hyperledger Fabric. The idea was, why don't we try to share the KYC process itself? So if I want to get a loan, I go to a bank and I'm trying to show them that I have a good credit ratings. This stuff is expensive for the bank and for me. Why can I not take this KYC process and now they know I'm Jonathan Levi, I'm from Israel, blah, 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 blah. They know everything about me. Why can I not take this process? Let's say it costs like, let's say $100. Why can we not reuse it so that I can get like 200 loans, right? So I don't have to go through the KYC again and again, which is part of the kind of user experience. It's also like part of the long-term value of a user, right? So just this very simple kind of use case is very difficult even in a permission setting, right? So I'm gonna have like a KYC portal where I basically get this information and I'm gonna upload this information and then I can selectively share it with different parties. So I do the KYC once and share it with anyone I want. So if you think about decentralized identity kind of mentality, right, that I'm like self-sovereign, I'm gonna go with my identity, go and I go through the KYC process, I own this process. And then I'm going to share it with like 7 different banks. No regulator allowed that in the US. Just to tell you, this is just one example. 3 years down the line, the regulator doesn't want other people to share this information. And in a way, you think, okay, so why am I bothering to try to kind of own my identity if anyway I have to go later on and upload all my credentials to somebody else? So it's not easy in any settings. That's what I'm saying. If you want to be like law-abiding, there are two kind of mechanisms, right? One is to go, and play with the system like I try to do and I'm still trying to do. Like, I don't believe that you should not pay taxes. Like, it's good for the short term, but it's not good for the long term, right? So I don't have to pay like until, let's say, October, but I do need to pay like in the end. So I do believe in governance, but it's not clear whether trying to build everything to address what the regulator wants always makes sense. Like, sometimes, for example, the fact that Ethereum is not a security is a big thing. It's a really big thing. You know, so we can use that. We can try to see how we can decentralize this in a way that I don't have a single point of failure or a single point of trust. And this is where zero knowledge can really help. So imagine me having, like, Tim's example was, I don't need to tell you everything, but you just need to know that I'm over 18 or over 21. That's one example. I just want to show you that I'm an accredited investor, so I need to show you my bank balance. That's another example. So there are many ways where we can use zero knowledge in order to, and I don't mind like arguing with the regulators and to prove that we can comply, because sometimes systems are just kind of, you know, they're just there because of the legacy, right? People are used to like sending faxes, and before people were used to like sending pigeons. That it still works, you can still send pigeons probably, but you know, we need to modernize stuff, and I think we need to reach a level where it doesn't make sense to use the old systems, but it will take some time. So let me talk about that example. I'm gonna talk about Fabric CA. I'm gonna move from Fabric very soon, but this is like one of the big things now in permission space, where you can take Identity Mixer, which is a mechanism, by the way, Identity Mixer was launched or basically published, like this is 2001, by Jan Kamenisch, and so that was Zurich research from IBM. And back in the day, the idea was to say, look, if I want to watch a movie, I can just prove to somebody that I'm over 12. So there are some movies that I can watch, like the PG-12, and I don't need to say everything else. But, you know, this is the model, and it is, like, if you look at the cryptography, it's basically a range proof over my age. So I can show you that I'm over 21 or over 12 or over 18, but not to show you, like, my date of birth. So this is one model. There's a Fabric CA model where you basically get a certificate from a certificate authority, centralized, but you can run it in a decentralized way that you have like more than one CA, et cetera, et cetera. Another model is basically, I don't know if it's the right slide. I missed a slide in between. But another model is to basically say, I want to hide like the entire transaction from anyone else. So when I missed a slide here, but I'll try to overcome it. So assume that you have these slides without text. So if you work in a centralized area where you have like, so imagine this blockchain. If I know, like if I look at the difference between an open blockchain and a closed blockchain, or a public chain versus a permission chain, in a permission chain, I basically know who are the validators. And in a public chain, let's say Ethereum or Bitcoin, I can just run a node, I can start mining, right? I can start validating transactions and get money. And that's why it's open. Whenever we're gonna work with a KYC system that really allows a centralized party to be the funnel, right? To charge, or basically to be in charge of who gets into the system, then you are in a centralized world. The question is, how do we play with zero knowledge to allow more privacy and more control over data? And I'll show very soon that I don't think that we should use zero knowledge just for privacy. I think we can do like much more than that. But we built this system that allows you to connect different chains, like public, not public, it doesn't matter. So you have like Stellar, you have Sovereign, you have different identities, but our strength actually is that we have like a registry where you can discover different chains, but you can move data, or you can pay with Ethereum or with Stellar or with other coins while still having your own identity. So this slide is actually made by other people, not just us, but the idea is to later on have this kind of permission, non-permission space, but this is like highly regulated environments. Like if you look at the financial services, it's very difficult to decentralize it. It's very, very difficult. I think there are two reasons, right? Like one reason is like the players. Like it's a very, you know, people are competing for years and that's kind of the nature of the business. But at the same time, the regulators are also kind of, it's a highly regulated space, but it's not clear to me always if the regulator is the friend or the enemy. I'll be honest with you. Because sometimes the regulation is a pain. Like what we try to do with Bitcoin. Well, let's try to have like DeFi, right? Like the decentralized finance. And then the regulations are like, oh my God, come on, we are not trying to trade. We are just trying to basically connect, right? Supply and demand. So we're just the Craigslist. Why am I a trade? Like, why am I considered an exchange? I'm not exchanging anything. I don't hold custody. So that was like where I was like, oh my God, this is so difficult to explain to the regulations or to the regulator that we're not an exchange. But at the same time, the regulators are the guys that are actually sometimes saving the citizen from some of the banks. So it's not clear to me like where we need to go and show the regulators that actually it's better to open up and where we should like kind of comply with, okay, let's do the KYC and the AML that you require in order for us to trade and to remove friction. I'll give you an example of how we really opened up a few things. So this is a model of decentralized identity with attestations. And it's kind of nice in terms of like working in a KYC-friendly environment while not having one person or one entity controlling the entire space. So the idea was you have a user, and it doesn't matter if it's an account, an organization, a node, and you basically come and register your identity somewhere else. So you have your, so instead of calling myself Jonathan, imagine that I'm gonna call myself J17, okay? So that's my alias. Once I have this decentralized identity or identifier, I'm gonna go to different, it's not KYC providers, but different entities, and I'm gonna get some attestations about my age, about my credit history, about my current balance. And the nice thing about this model, this is a very generic model, is that not one entity has all this information. So I can have an attestation from a bank telling you this is my current, or this is my current like bank balance, but it can also give you a range. It has more than $1,000 in the account. Somebody else can tell you that I have a driving license, and a third person or a third organization that you trust will tell you something about my academic history. Now, if you want to decentralize, it has to be, the model should be an assertion that is relatively privacy preserving, like we need to define what we don't want to show, what we don't want to share, and what is really needed. And what is nice about this model in general is that you will be able to kind of provide the very minimum amount of information that you need in order to go through a service. Now, it gives you some control. Like, I believe in a world where in the future, you are going to choose the service providers or who you're going to work with based on their requirements. At the moment, it's very, very restrictive, right? Like, okay, try to find another, I don't know. I think it's very difficult today to have financial transactions without banks. I don't know if you guys noticed that, right? But it's very difficult, even if you raise a lot of money. Without KYC, you can't move this money back into your account. But I also think that, so look, we're a fintech that works with a lot of big techs, which is a good thing and a bad thing. You know, like some people in the, especially in this environment that are trying to kind of rebel and go like, and have this kind of anarchism. And also one of these guys as well, I'm really into like privacy and Mimblewimble and Zcash. And I'm trying to help a lot of people. You see me in many events, we're helping, we're competing, we're like coming to hackathons and we provide a lot of code out to the world. But at the same time, I think that this revolution will come with the big kind of guys coming into the space, and we need to find a way for them to push the regulators to understand that actually this is not so bad. Like, the best model that I can predict is if we can show people that they don't really want to have all this information. So instead of me fighting with Google, hey, come on, don't have all this information on me, if I can have a model where, let's say, Google is one example, but let's say if Facebook will finally realize that there's a huge risk to Facebook having all this information about me, I think that's a much better kind of settings. This is why I really like what Jordi is doing with like client-side, you know, snarks. So if I can have a model where I can prove to people, hey, this is what I have without giving you this information, and we will be able to convince slowly, it will take some time, but I think it's possible, to prove to the corporations that they don't really need to have all this data, that it's too much risk. You want to just sell me a beer. Why do you care, like, what's my date of birth? Tomorrow there's going to be a breach. Your reputation, your, you know, your shares, There's too much value at risk for you as an organization to basically store so much information that you don't need. And you should see it as risk, not as an asset. So this is where I think that kind of such models, maybe not necessarily this as it is, but this is like a nice start of getting a decentralized framework where people make attestations and it's not all in one place. There's no single point of failure or a single point of trust. Let me tell you a little bit more about zero knowledge. Do you have 5 more minutes? Are you guys, you have some patience? Okay. So let's talk about some assertions that people are making about zero knowledge stuff. So this is where I'm taking my gloves off. And let's talk about like wrong assumptions that actually affect security, scalability, and actually the usability of systems. So one big problem that I see, and we've been building, I don't know, I think more than 7 production blockchains that are actually live every day with a very big uptime, SLAs and stuff. But people are making a lot of wrong assertions or assumptions about the adversarial model. And now I'm putting my kind of, I don't know, applied cryptographer's hat. So main problem that we see in Bitcoin, right? So proof of work is great. It's like the least common denominator. You know, like it's very easy for me to basically calculate hashes and to compare them. That's nice. But remember one thing that is actually affecting everything in blockchain. If people collude, it's not always visible. So it's very difficult to know if I have a 51% attack or not. So the big problem that I see in kind of proofs is that, and especially in zero knowledge proofs, is the fact, and I see it a lot in permission, but it's true in general. People think that if I prove to you something, you have to accept the proof. Okay, so for example, and it's an old classic model, but I think this is a very big mistake. So the fact that you prove to me something and you have non-repudiation, like you cannot deny, like you can prove to me beyond any doubt that you are over 21. I'm still not gonna let you into the club. Okay, so I see it in permission space, right? People think, but I have a certificate. I have the CA, and the CA told me, and he can tell you, look, he signed, I'm over 21. I said, okay, sorry, dude, the club is full. No, it's not personal. The server is not available. So the fact that you have a proof, beyond any doubt, and somebody gave you a certificate, doesn't grant you the automatic right for me to serve you. And many people think, oh, but look, I can prove to you. So the right way to look at zero knowledge proofs is basically the prover needs to convince the verifier that he has a possession of some knowledge without leaking knowledge, right? So the zero knowledge part is basically me not revealing to you the secret that I wanna basically hide or keep away from you. That's the zero knowledge part. But at the same time, me not leaking this information. So I think one of the nicest ways to look at zero knowledge, and this is why I'm becoming a little bit geeky, like the nice example. So Jordi sometimes talk about like, let's have like 2 balls and I can switch them and then you can tell me if I switched or not without telling me which one is like, let's say blue or red. And that's a classic example. A stronger example is probably something like, I have some, I don't know, superpower and I want to prove to you that I have this superpower. So here is an example. Assume that I have a tree and I have the ability to count all the leaves in the tree. I want to prove to you that I have this ability to count leaves. But if I'm going to go to the tree and I'm going to tell you what is the number of the tree, so I'm going to reveal to you something that you couldn't do it because you are not Jonathan superhuman thing that can kind of, you know, very easily count like leaves on trees. So the model is going to be, why don't you not show me, and you can take one leaf away from the tree. And without me telling you how many leaves I have on the tree, I'll be able to tell you if you removed one or not.
How is that different from the ball swapping?
It's the same thing, but I think it's more, like the ball swapping is exactly the same thing. But I think the ball swapping is something that you can guess like with 0.5. The leaves is actually, it's the same mentality. And the boss thing I have to explain to you statistically and probabilistically, because I could guess. With the leaves is the same thing, but I'm not showing you. The thing is, you should believe that I can see, kind of differentiate between the balls. The same thing I can count the chips. It's exactly the same. It's exactly the same concept. But what is important here is that I really don't want to reveal this information or let you compute something that you couldn't compute without my input. Just like the number of the tree, the leaves on the tree, right? With the balls, you can learn a little bit from what I'm doing, like probabilistically, but after a while you say, look, it doesn't make sense that Jonathan will be right 60 times in a row. Like, what's the probability that I'm gonna be right 60 times in a row? It's the same mentality. What we're trying to do, even in permission space, right, is to prove to you that I'm part of a group. So it's a set membership kind of example. So I'm gonna use zero knowledge proofs in order to show you, look, I am a banker, or I'm in the healthcare industry, or I'm in insurance. And this is where it's nice. This is if people are asking me like what they should work on, this is like when I think this is like really useful. If we, like, I don't know, I'm kind of a law-abiding, kind of rebellious person, I think, like over the last few years. So if we can find a model where we can use this technology in order to prove to a regulator that you are doing the right thing, I think it's a much better setting. For example, whenever you get a company to want to prove that we allow only people that are over 21 or 18 to buy beer, that's where they will really invest in zero knowledge. If you're gonna go just like, you know, head against the wall and just try to disrupt in a way that is not beneficial to the system, it's a lot more difficult. I'm not saying it's not impossible. I was just able to be much more successful, or as a company, we were much more successful when we found kind of the joint go-to-market where people actually aligned with us, said, actually, we do need this technology in order to make money, or in order to be more efficient, or in order to basically prove to the regulator that you passed the KYC. And when we show to them, but you understand that you don't need to know this information. Like, why do you want to know who is that person? You just want to get like your transaction fee, right? Let's just make sure that the regulator is happy and you have the minimal set of information that you need. That's a much better setting than me trying to go all in and go all kind of in the privacy settings, right? And I want to mention like what happened with Zcash, right? It was the same vulnerability that we saw before, where the scary part, like the recent bug, right? You couldn't tell. That's the main problem. If you go all in private and you have no adoption, it's very difficult to tell if something is wrong. This is why I think we need to be able to have the trust and the governance, but we also need to be able to build a system where the parties have the incentive to keep your privacy or to not know what's going on. I think that's the winning model from my end. Okay. Thank you. Questions or after?
No, yeah. Time, let's say 5 minutes.
Any questions? Yes, please. Yes.
You're basically suggesting that you go to one party each and validate or attest one piece of data, correct?
So we build a system where you can have a combination of attestations from different parties. So for example, I want to show you that I pay taxes. I don't need to show you my tax report. So we're going to go to like one of the big fours, Deloitte, Ernst & Young, et cetera, et cetera. And if you, I think this is where the detail is important. You need to accept Ernst & Young's attestation that I'm okay. You don't have to, but hopefully it will convince you. So we have to have a process where you say, look, I need one of the big fours to show me or to attest that you pay taxes. And that gives you a level of separation, so I don't really need to give you the raw material. And it doesn't have to be one party. It's like a set of parties. Any of them can work, right? It's a way to decentralize it a little bit instead of having only one vendor attesting and maybe I can bribe somebody. But if I have like 20, maybe it's more difficult. Maybe you need more than one attestation.
If we're assuming those consortium that you showed earlier, mm-hmm. then they would share this data again.
It depends. The fact that I show you, the fact that I go through a KYC process doesn't mean that you have to share it. Maybe like, so the model that we have in the permission setting, we have like two steps. Step one is who has access to the system. And look, it can be good and it can be bad. You know, like when you have permission settings, if you look, if you put this, if you put ahead of like, I want censorship resistance, then of course having a permission setting is not censorship resistance because people can censor you, right? They will not let you in. But at the same time, in some other settings, when you have permission, it's easier for you to satisfy regulations. So maybe only banks can see it, or only doctors can see this sensitive data, only a trial data, only in Nevada can, you know? So it actually, it limits the domain of who can see stuff, and it allows you to move faster. So it really depends on your problem. So, yeah, there's no one solution to fit all. It's just, I think we have different problems with different solutions for these problems. Yeah. Anything else? All right. Get decentralized, guys. Bye-bye. Cheers. Thank you. Cheers.